Wake up, everybody, no more sleeping in bed. No more back thinking, time for thinking ahead. The world has changed so very much from what it used to be. There's so much hatred, war and poverty.
Oh. Welcome to You Gotta Laugh to Keep From Crying. My name is O.W. Sweeney, and I'm here with my good brother and comrade, Richard Koritz. How you doing today, my good brother?
Oliver Wendell Sweeney. All it's right, a pleasure right, to be right, here right, with right, you, right, as
right,
always.
All right.
And it's great to be sponsored by North Carolina Triad for Justice.
Yep. Where you can be reached at
336-272-2758. And we have quite a full list of guests today.
Yes, we do.
Thanks to you, brother.
Hey, well.
And do you want to introduce?
No, I'll let you go ahead. So
okay,
first, okay. Look it down.
Okay. Over to our far left, I don't know if that means politically or not, we'll find out, his brother Lewis Beveridge, and brother Stewart.
Leo B. Stewart.
There you go.
Is the next brother
from the Renaissance Co-op,
and both of them are from the Renaissance
Co-op committee. Right.
And then we have brother Ralph Johnson from the Northeast Concerned Citizens.
Correct.
So it's a pleasure to have you brothers with us.
Well, thank you.
Pleasure to be here.
Thank you. Let's come on down the line once again.
All right.
And while we're in the habit of leaning over, Lewis, it's my pleasure to give you a. One of our
give the history of our highest award.
Okay, our highest award. Oh, years ago, when O.W. and I were both postal union leaders in this city,
mm-hmm.
We were part of an effort to try to get postal accountability. The word here we go with accountability already. We had managers gone wild in the post office in their abuse of the workers,
mm-hmm.
and so there was an effort among the different unions. And I was with the letter carriers, and O.W. was with the American Postal Workers Union. But together, he and I happened to be the ones who devised this button back about 20 years ago. And to us, this is the essence of why we have this show.
Oh.
Workers deserve respect.
Yes.
And so, Lewis, it's my pleasure to present you with it. I hope you'll wear it proudly.
Thank you.
And
Mr. Ralph Johnson, my pleasure to print you this with one.
Thank you very much.
And brother Leo B.
Those buttons are understanding that the workers are the majority in the world.
Amen.
And they need to stand up and take control of what
Absolutely.
Their destinies are.
Definitely.
And brother Leo B. Stewart already has a button from his previous guest time with us on the show.
Yeah, because he's been here before.
That's another way of putting it.
Yeah. So I guess we might as well get on the topic.
Let's
do
it.
As far as Ralph, if you'll give him a little small brief background of what the...
Concerned Citizens?
Yeah, it's a Concerned Citizen all about.
Absolutely. The Concerned Citizen was formed in 1998, and it came out of the issue involving the White Street Landfill and the Winn-Dixie Shopping Center. There were citizens that got together because of the disappointment of the grocery store leaving and also the landfill possibly being expanded. And so they got together and so we can have a voice collectively in that community to do something to kind of thwart that effort. And that's basically what the...
So are you saying, Ralph, that effort back in 98 was for both things, for the White Street Landfill
Absolutely.
And to try to
because
have
both
a decent...
both were going on at the same time.
Okay. Yeah, I was with the Greensboro Human Relations Commission back then, and we had a meeting in your community to try to highlight the issue of the landfill, but I did not remember that the issue of having a co-op supermarket or a community supermarket at that time, when something along those lines was involved.
Well, I think that the community co-op, I think, came after.
Right. Okay.
That was after.
Okay.
That wasn't during that same time.
Okay. But the same group of people that were concerned about the first one, more or less, were the people that ended up being concerned about the second one.
Yes.
Okay.
So one of y'all gentlemen want to speak on the Renaissance Co-op Committee?
Well, the Renaissance Co-op, we started over a year ago. We celebrated our first year last month.
You don't look that old.
And it's a learning process for all of us. And the thing about it that all of us in the neighborhood, we go out and shop wherever we do, we take the money out of the community, and there's nothing put back in it. So that's the purpose that we want to be an advocate for having the Renaissance Co-op supermarket there. So we could keep our monies in the neighborhood, bring jobs in the neighborhood, and make it a better place for all of us to live. And it takes educating more the neighborhood, that letting them know that this is good for us. It's a we thing, you know, and that's what we're doing.
Well, you know, one of my idols, Malcolm X, said, when the man come in your neighborhood in the daytime and collect all your resources, when he leave out at nighttime, he leave you with a ghetto.
That's right.
So
that's
right. It's a thing about changing money. The money changes hands in the community more than once,
right,
which upholds the community.
And here's another thing about the Renaissance Co-op. All of us, most of us belong to, are members of an entity that where we go and shop. Every year we renew our membership, and whether it's a $50 or $100 membership, that's what we pay. In the co-op, you be a member, it costs $100 for the family. And it's a one-time thing. So we get to share, and it produces foods for the neighborhood that we want. You know, no one's gonna come and tell us what we need to eat, because we're gonna have everything that the neighborhood go out and shop for anyway. So it's a better plan for everybody, you know.
Yes, you know, our concern is that in addition to not having a source of food, there's also opportunities where we're not being educated on economics and what is the value of the dollar. You know, if you bring in another chain store and the chain stores have refused to come to East Greensboro for 15 years, if you bring in another one, well, you're just going to have that same transfer of wealth. Like I said, every night that money goes out of the community. Developing a community-owned, democratically controlled entity that provides food for everybody in the community gives us an opportunity to learn what's the value of the dollar. You know, what's the value of our work? How do we provide, you know, righteous jobs for people as opposed to exploitive jobs? You know, how does the community come together and make these decisions about what's in the community's best interest? Cooperative form of business gives us that opportunity unlike any other form of business. So it was very exciting to start looking into that and delving into that type of form versus, again, going out and lobbying, you know, Walmart or Save-A-Lot or somebody else who's just going to hit us upside the head and take our money, feed us substandard garbage, and then run on out the door.
Well, that's where I want to pick up on what you said, Lewis, because we're living in a time where we now have genetically modified foods. Mm-hmm. So often we don't know what is being put into these foods. It's all about the bottom line of these monopoly capitalist producers, mm-hmm, of this food, that whatever they can, however they can manufacture this food the cheapest, that's what they're gonna throw into the community.
That's
so
right.
So I was glad to hear you discussing this question of, well, it seems to me that, you know, with a community-owned and controlled co-op, that you're going to have a lot more to say about the kind of food that the community is going to have available to it.
Definitely.
At that store. So that's really good. And I know Leo B, from his previous guest time on our show, has background in dealing with food.
Yes.
And so maybe, Leo, you would comment about that aspect of it, about the community having some control over the food.
Think about this. We already have a commitment from A&T, okay? And they're working on it. My experience, my family's from India. I come from a family of producing our own needs and wants. I'm a meat cutter by trade. I went to school and did architect in Arkansas. But fortunately for me, I couldn't work at it because of the heat, the paint, and the different stuff, because I have asthma. So I was fortunate enough that my grandfather had his own place, a meat cutting place. And after school, I used to go there and help him cut meat. So I have all that experience. I run a company in Boston. I run one in Georgia. And Southern Food brought me here for that same purpose. So I have that experience about food, you know, meats, and what we should eat and how we should, you know, back in my time, 16 years ago when I was a teenager.
So you're older than you claimed before.
We didn't eat no fresh meat. And we didn't have these refrigerators and freezers.
Right.
You know, anything we had, whether it's chicken or fish, we marinated it for 3 or 4 days, and then when we would eat it, we were healthier then. We didn't have all these diseases that we have now, you know. So we have to stop looking at quick fix and do what we used to do. And that's what I'm bringing to this co-op. I'm letting you know how we should eat, how we should live better for our own good. You know, that's my experience.
Thanks. Ralph, you got any comments or thoughts about this issue?
No, I am 100% with the co-op. I think our charge was getting the entire shopping center developed.
Okay. Go ahead.
The co-op, you know, was something, I think this has been almost a year ago. They came to one of our meetings and had talked about the cooperative in terms of the food and healthy eating, that kind of thing. And I don't know of too many people that are against that particular aspect of it. Our charge, which we started in 2003 with a plan that was sanctioned by the city, was to figure out what we wanted in the shopping center. You know, we wanted a restaurant, we wanted a pharmacy, we wanted a healthcare facility, in addition to the grocery store.
And how are we doing right now? What's our current status?
Well, it's kind of in limbo right now, but I think it's on the table. You know, they're looking at a developer right now in terms of actually getting the shopping center. But as far as...
What do you mean by that?
Well, the city is going to sell the shopping center to a developer.
And is the co-op and the concerned citizens, are they in favor of that or opposed to it?
Well, I mean, there's been some mixed, you know, just being honest about it, there's been some mixed feelings about it. But as far as the co-op, it's been a constant. You know, I think everyone is in favor of the co-op having straight to 10,000 square feet in that shopping center. I think the problem is that what else do we do with the rest of the shopping center? You got to have those other businesses in there. And, you know, it would be a nice thing for all of it, you know, like once the shopping center is developed, all of it to come up out of the ground at the same time. Rather than just having just the co-op, you need other tenants.
Right. And they help each other to succeed.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And so I think that's that piece of it is missing. Mm-hmm. You know, because like I said, we definitely need, you know, there was a study done, like I said, in 2003. And these are some of the things, I was part of that study. These are some of the things that the citizens said they wanted. This is what they wanted. Right. And we still don't have it.
Well, is it because we don't have enough political power in that community yet to demand it?
I think what it is, basically, is that it was put on the back burner. I think back in 2003. I mean, they spent, I believe, $100,000 for this study. Mm-hmm. And it was put on the shelf. I got a copy of it,
right.
You know. And this is something that I haven't really been able to grapple with. And I think, you know, my focus has always been on community. You know, if this is what you want, this is what you should get. And I only think that's only right. And, you know, we've been kind of pushed to the side. And it's been like that over the last 10 years.
And, Lewis, do you think that's you see it pretty much the same way?
To a degree. I think the issue now is a lot different in the sense that there's been some mud thrown in the game. I agree totally with, you know, his assessment in terms of, you know, what the community needs, where it should come from.
Right.
But what happened is instead of the community being led in a process to arrive at a single conclusion, there was an effort made to split and divide. Okay, and so we had...
We call that divide and conquer.
Right. And we've been able to demonstrate that what was presented to the community as a viable option wasn't a viable option. You know, the previous plan that was on the table entailed giving the community control of 20,000 square feet of the shopping center, 10,000 square feet of which would be operated by the co-op. And then if the community could take the 20,000 square feet and bring it up to speed and make it work, fine. If not, it would revert back to the control of the folks who were seeking to own the whole of the shopping center. Now, what we figured out, or if you know anything about development, is that it takes about $2.50 a square foot to keep the lights on in a building. Okay? If you have a 20,000 square foot building at $2.50 a square foot, that means you need $50,000 just to keep the lights on in it. The co-op was going to be paying a $2,000 a month rent, which was $24,000. Then the community was going to get 5,000 square feet, which you weren't going to get any rent from, which left $26,000 to be taken care of by 5,000 square feet. So that meant that the rent on just that alone was going to have to be about $6 just to keep the lights on and what. But you hadn't hired anybody to open the place or clean it or any of that sort of stuff. Hadn't brought it up to speed. So it was a doomed plan. Okay, and so in an effort to try to help people understand that this was a doomed plan, there was the splitting that took place. And, you know, we had certain factions that were pushing this plan, we got to do it, we got to do it. And we're saying, look, this is not a personal thing, this is a numbers thing. When you do business development, you go to the numbers. It's not a whether I like you or don't like you. It's got to work. And it wouldn't work. And so when we were able to see that, then people started getting a little bit of light. And now the current thing is we have a self-help credit union who said they would be interested in coming in and buying the whole shopping center and developing it. And they put forward a plan. Some people say that that plan is the same plan that the previous folks had. It's not, but that's there. But what's happening now is that our community has to understand a proposal is a proposal. So in other words, you take the proposal, you cut it into pieces, and you figure out which parts you can agree with, and then you counter-propose things that make it work in your favor. We are the power. You know, Northeast Greensboro is just a beautiful place. East Greensboro, we just turned over city council. We just elected two new people to city council. Folks didn't even think that would happen. Okay? In doing that, we've, again, once again, shown that the citizens of East Greensboro care about what goes on, and they will exercise their power. Well, now it's time to exercise our power and say, this is what we're going to do with the shopping center. But we have to come up with one plan that makes sense, and we tell everybody who wants to play, this is how we're going to play.
Yeah, I think that maybe there's one ingredient that's missing. And I know less about this whole process than any of you four brothers do. But I do know something about public service and about public entities having been and remaining active in the fight to defend a public postal service at a time where Wall Street and in cooperation with the U.S. Congress and the Postmaster General are trying to privatize the postal service. Mm-hmm. And so I always believe in seeing where the moneyed interests in a country that's dominated by Wall Street, what's the stake of the moneyed interests? And it strikes me, for one thing, that by delaying this thing 15 years already, that's 15 years of, as Leo B. described it, I think very well, of the money continuing to leave that community. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And so one of the things we need to keep in mind is that we're going to have to struggle for the hearts and minds of the people.
Right.
So we're all hearts and minds are one.
Right.
Right? That's something, and that's a struggle. Mm-hmm. And it's a struggle because there are moneyed interests that have a stake in keeping this thing going and not going anywhere.
Definitely.
So that's, I just wanted to throw that
out. Oh, no, you're right on. And that's the beauty of a cooperative form of business, because you have to accept responsibility for that. You know, you have to get on the ground now and sell yourself to individual people. You know, you can't come in with a major marketing campaign and have the dog and pony show and, you know, run a game on everybody. You have to get on the ground and talk person to person, knee to knee, to help them understand that we're not playing a game. This is for real. This is serious. And we are fighting against moneyed interests, but together we can win that.
Right. And, of course, that a lot of that depends on us, the 99%, so to speak, being as serious about what we're about as the 1% are about being serious about
exactly.
what they're about.
Exactly.
And plus, you got to understand that you got to change a lot of mindsets.
Oh, definitely. Yeah.
And that's one of the hardest things to do, is to change the mindsets of the people who are being victimized.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
They're so used to doing things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when they say bad habits are hard to break,
right.
And they have to break the hard, bad habits and understand, yes. They got to stop doing for others and do for yourself.
There you go.
And they got to realize going outside the community is not really helping them.
Sure.
So, and that's the difficult kind of part of things right there.
Yeah, and when I had an experience, so we went to Claremont and did a presentation back in the spring. And during that presentation, one of the residents of Claremont stood up in the meeting and she said, well, you know, it's nothing in this for me. I just want a store now. And she, you know, railed against, you know, waiting and developing. She just wanted a store. And about 4 months later, she shows up at a co-op meeting, and I didn't even know who she was, but she came up to the table kind of sheepishly, and she said, you remember who I am? I said, no, ma'am. She said, well, good. And then she reminded me who she was, and she said, I thought about what you were able to explain to us, and it makes perfect sense that, first of all, I had to be concerned about more than just myself and more than the here and now. And she joined our co-op that evening and has taken on responsibility for expanding the message in Claremont. So, you know, I have a lot of faith in our community. And you know, this populist movement, when you see Occupy and we just had the worker strike and things of this nature,
right.
You know, if you go to Egypt, if you go to Libya, Syria, you know, all over the world, folk are like, we're tired of the moneyed interest kicking us in our teeth. We'd rather have nothing than continue to let you guys, you know, and I think it's that time in the United States. You know, we're seeing more and more evidence of people deciding to stand up and realize, because no one's been protected. You know, the rich have gotten filthy rich,
right.
And everybody who thought they were invited to the party is sitting outside and they don't have anything, you know. And so it's a great time to be embarking on something like that.
You say all those who thought they were being invited to the party, yes. But what you understand is that they never was invited to the party.
Right.
And they never understood that they wasn't invited to the party.
That's right.
It was just like what they say, putting the carrot before the horse.
That's right.
Okay. They give you this dream that you're thinking that you can make it,
mm-hmm.
But you're not going to make it.
Never wait.
They let a certain amount through, but everybody can't make it.
Mm-hmm.
It is easier for everybody to be on a more of a living wage type of thing rather than everybody being up there making it all.
Yeah.
Because my understanding, I mean, when I was attending Mega Evans College, I failed economics. I had to come out in the real world to find out what economics means.
Right.
And all these big words they give you in economics, all economics mean is having money circulate.
That's right.
That's all it means,
right.
Plain and simple. So the people have to understand they have to circulate their money,
sure.
Among themselves.
Yeah. Sure.
The more it circulates in your community, the better you circulate in your
That's
community.
Right. And we do have control.
That's right.
You know, and you know, I talk to my son a lot about things like, you know, you see $100 pair of tennis shoes, and then, you know, you come back in the store later and that pair of shoes is marked down to $29. And I said, why do you think that is? I don't know. I said, because people didn't buy them. You know, if you don't buy them, guess what? The price comes right on down. So we are the ones who actually control the pricing and, you know, and how rich these folks actually get. If we don't spend, guess what happens?
I just want to throw in something for you to think about.
Sure.
That party that we thought we were invited to.
Mm-hmm.
It's called the Republicrat Party. Let's
wait
not forget.
Wait a minute. I'm not going to leave the Democrats off that.
No, he got them at
the
end.
Republicrat
okay, then.
Party. Yeah, the Republicans then. And the Democrats. And we are not a party to those parties.
To either one of them. You know my definition of the Republican and the Democrat.
I do.
You know the difference, don't you?
Yep. Yeah.
And here's another thing. We have to remember that these are different times. These are tougher times and they're different. There was a time when, way back when, we prayed, our forefathers prayed and waited on the Lord to change things. He has given us full authority. We can change things. We could pray, but we don't have to wait.
Yeah,
we have to make that move.
I understand what you're saying.
And we don't want that handout. We want a hand up. Because in Northeast Greensboro, is our own money that the city is providing, our taxes money. And when the city talk about how much they have done in Greensboro, you can look all around. Northeast Greensboro, they haven't done nothing.
I understand.
Okay.
But you got to realize, like when I was growing up, they told me the Lord help those who help themselves.
That's right. That's right.
So, still
yeah, it still
and,
does.
And if we don't get up and help ourselves,
that's
ain't
right.
Nobody going to help
yeah.
us.
You can't be waiting.
Brothers, that's a very important point, and we're running out of time, and so I'd like to give everybody a last chance to, or we'd like to give everybody a last chance to communicate what it is that you think that our viewers need to do, especially those in the Northeast or those that are for justice anywhere in the Greensboro area.
I'll say this. I think the key to this right now is for people to come out and get involved, understand what's going on, understand that there are issues that are out there that are affecting you. And I'm appealing to the concerned citizens of Northeast Greensboro and the citizens of Greensboro.
There you go.
Okay, to become more involved in this issue. We need that shopping center developed, the entire shopping center, not one space in the shopping center, the entire shopping center.
Right.
We don't need part of it to be standing and the other part to be sitting on the ground. And the only way that that's going to happen is that people get involved. And I also want to put a little plug in. January 23rd, there's going to be a meeting. And it's going to be publicized. Mm-hmm. It's going to be a meeting of Appeal Center regarding the shopping center as a whole. And hopefully that people will come out and listen to to some of the comments that are going to be made and the presentation that's going to be made.
And hopefully they'll make comments themselves.
Yeah, absolutely.
And one of y'all want to say something because the music is ready to start.
Yes, I'm saying to all of you, Greensboro, our meeting is always the third Monday of the month at 7 o'clock. Come and be a part of it.
Tell them where the meeting's at.
Presbyterian Church.
Presbyterian Church of the Holy Cross. Phillips Avenue.
Well, it's been a pleasure.
Phillips and English Street.
It's been a pleasure, brothers. To have you on the show.
And we might have to have y'all on. It don't sound like we got to it.
But we want to make sure that the viewers know that they can reach us at 336-272-2758.
We didn't get a chance to allow y'all to give out any information when y'all will be reached. But if they call us, we'll pass it on.
Okay. Definitely. Thank you all for the invite. Right.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks again.
All right.
Just this one.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
Well, you're fresh out of school. You're looking for some work. It's McDonald's time. You're 30 years on the job. Get you a place on the unemployment line. Where you work like a dog. Pay all your